And now it's hard to breathe.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please present to the stage, Jax Jones.
Yo, what's up? Shall we get a bit of crowd interaction going? When I say I am, you say S. I am?
Yes.
Hey. Cool, so thank you for the introduction, bro. My name is Jax Jones. I want to talk to you today about a song that I wrote called Breathe. Just to give you a bit of background, the song Tomorrow is nominated for an Ivor Novello Award for Most Performed Song, and the Ivor Novello's is a prestigious songwriting award. And I'm in the category with George Ezra and other notable like singer-songwriters from the UK. It's a big thing, so something I've always wanted to do. So I thought it's timely to kind of share how I created this record, which has now done 3.6 something million sales and 600 and something million streams or whatever. So for anyone that wants to, as I call, you know, secure the bag, like this is one way you can do it. For me, the kind of anatomy of making a hit falls into two sides. There's the songwriting side and then there's the music side. And what I've always found is people tend, within our trade, tend to focus on the music. But for me, what makes it special is the song is kind of what sells it, and then the music has to be as good as the song. But to compete on the world stage, and I do house music, so comparatively EDM in the most traditional sense, when we think of like Calvin Harris or the late great Avicii, they understood the value of song and they understood how that complements the music. And so I just wanted to share with that with you today, do you know what I'm saying? So kind of how I approach songwriting as well as the music. The reason why I know a little bit about this is I was in a band before. So I've written with some of the best songwriters in the world, Toby Gad, Egg White, Steve Mack. So I've learned a few things, and so I kind of put it all into these records. Before I start though, this isn't a common topic for electronic music producers. So I wanted to share what I think about before I go to write a song, because you're sitting in quite an emotional and quite intense environment with another person. I sing a little bit, but this person has to, you have to write and you have to capture all these emotions within, you know, 6 hours that you're sitting with someone. So for any electronic musician out there who wants to take any of this advice, the first thing you should consider is be positive. It's valuable to, no idea is a bad idea. When you're sitting opposite someone, you might feel like your idea is whack, just contribute. Half of songwriting is blagging. Like, it's kind of like, you kind of have to feel like you know what you're doing and then believe in it. Because ultimately, when you're sitting in a room, it's only a sum of all your tastes. The other thing is, know some sort of instrument. I know how to play piano, guitar, bass, and drums. But you only need to know one, really. And the only reason why is because when a singer sings something, you want to be ready. When they come up with a melody, you want to be able to complement that. If you're trying to write a sadder record or whatever it is, be patient. And even if you write a crud song, just learn from it. But that leads me on to the way I approached this particular song. So I don't make instrumentals, and I never have. I make little ideas, like, because I'm traveling and I make them always on the road. Those things only inform my sonic kind of productions. But in terms of going in to write a song, I go in with nothing. You don't know me, the one that goes, ooh, nah, nah, hey, that one. I wrote that with just a little bass line out on Xylinth and nothing else. The same with this one. And the reason I do that is because I like to leave it as open as possible. I don't like to be too emotionally attached to any instrumental. And I also, going back to what I say, being the song being the most important part of the record for me to compete on the world stage, that needs to be the focal point. So my music complements that. So I was going in with Ina Rolton, who's the other primary writer on Breathe. She's one of the best songwriters in the world. She's written Rockabye for Clean Bandit, Symphony for Clean Bandit, and most notably that we'd all know is How Deep Is Your Love, that one for Calvin Harris. So obviously man was proper nervous, yeah. I just written like a big pop tune with Instruction. I needed to be back in the clubs. And I'm thinking, how am I going to do this? And at the time, I was touring like crazy, which I know a lot of you guys can, relate to. So I had to maximize this one day. And I know I just gave you all these tips about how to get the best out of writing a song. Yo, it did not apply to this session. It was going horribly wrong. So I actually forgot to mention, it's good to kind of get to know each other. So we were talking for ages, and I had like some piano chords. I was trying to just give her something to inspire her. And she just was saying everything's crap. Ina's like really scary, if anyone ever works with her. And then I kind of stumbled on, we kind of started talking about like her husband and how she met her husband. And that's where all good songs come from. They come from a story. And I just played this, literally, this is the worst thing in the world. It was just like... yeah, just little progression. And then... worst bass sound in the world. Like, most bait progression in the world. And she was like, oh, that kind of reminds me of Madonna, like Frozen, like kind of mysterious. I was like, all right, cool. So like... then we started piecing together this story to the song. And the way you do that is we turned the microphone on and she just started spouting random words. And then you put words to those lyrics. To those sounds. So it should be like, eh. It'll be like, all of that. There's a lot of faff. And then you tidy it all up. Write the words, and then we ended up with this after day one. I put a little whack beat. Don't judge me. It's proper poor. Here we go. Hold on, let me turn that up. Can we have some... everyone's deaf in the room. They're all like musicians. Here we go. So this is what we had on day one.
And now it's hard to breathe. I'm not in love, it's just a game we do. I tell myself I'm not that into you, but I don't wanna sleep. It's quarter after three, and now it's hard to breathe. I'm not in love, it's just a thing we make. With skin on skin, I need this spell to break. But I don't wanna go, and I know that you know. You're in my head like dum dum da da.
So I can hear from that, you can hear the final song already there. That is the idea of the song.
Yeah.
And the idea is, from what you're saying, is much more important than the production at the beginning.
Exactly. So as you hear, the music's super rough, but you know, I knew from that idea, from that top line, I knew, okay, cool, this is gonna go. So there are two steps you could take. Some people would have just looped that over and over again, I made a 6-minute record out of it, and it's cool. But that ain't what I do. So I'm thinking, right, I need to complete that. So I think the best dance music are records that make you feel good, but then have the right melancholic, emotional qualities that make you feel something at the same time. All the classic ones of recent times, like We Found Love, Calvin Harris, Loud Places, Jamie XX, Crystal Waters, Gypsy Woman, yeah? They all have that. Some weird story, like, you're like, what is this? Like, and then you kind of dance into it. Oh, it feels good. So I knew I wanted to inject that into this. So I sent Ina away. I was like, yeah, cool. Please, can you deliver this to me? Because I was touring at the time. And then she sent me back this. No one's heard this. She's probably going to shoot me for saying this.
Out of control, come this close. The situation's getting out of control. I feel like I am lost. I know that's not in us. I need to try and find myself somehow. Rewind, erase, and find my way back. But I feel like I am lost. And you're in my blood like cool. A poison I can't escape. I'm like a zombie repeating the same mistake. I need to stop this before it is way too late. Is it too late? Cause now it's hard to breathe.
Yo, so I got that in my inbox. I was proper sad. I was like, Like, no one wants to be dancing to zombies and like poison and all this kind of thing. So that's the wrong side of it. That's why I want to show you the extreme so you know how far to go. Okay, so these are my rules. These are probably Aunt Ina's. This is how I think. Okay, when you write a song, you want to focus on minute details that anyone can relate to, but in a general sense. I took those ideas from Taylor Swift, no shame, because she talks about very specific things. So that's what you get into Breathe. You get the, it's a quarter after three, and now it's half to breathe. It's like, everyone knows what time a quarter after three is, but at the same time, it's in a very general way. There's no specific emotion in Breathe for you to latch onto. And that's where I just imagined, I wanted everyone around the world to kind of attach some sort of personal story. And by doing that, you want it to be a bit general. And you too were really good at that.
I think that's quite common with a lot of really good hit songs. Like, you look at Adele as well. Like, exactly. you could just put yourself into her song and you can be like, I felt that before.
Exactly. But then she doesn't pin it down to personal. I don't really believe in songwriting to be some spiritual revelation, like, oh, you know, I went through this really bad thing. I definitely like to repackage it so that everyone can relate to it. It's not selfish to me. So those are where those things come from. So when you write something, when you're playing music in a club environment especially, you only have a few minutes to catch people's ears. So those kind of things really mean something. The other thing is certain grammatical errors, like the first line of Breathe is, you're my discretional sin. Fam, discretional sin doesn't make any sense. But it's kind of a Norwegian approach to songwriting, as in, it sounds good, doesn't really matter if it makes sense. And then the last thing that I wanted to approach in terms of the song is obviously the Marmite bit. And I call this the Marmite bit because I think this is the bit that made it a hit. Is the dum-dum-da-da-da-da, dum-dum-da-da-da. I remember I talked about the song with Martin Solveig and he's like, bro, I wouldn't have put that bit in the song. Like, that bit was whack. I was like, bro, I'm sitting here talking to you because of that bit in the song. The reason why is because I don't even remember that song by Rihanna, Umbrella. Everyone remembers Ella, Ella, eh, eh. The post hook is a powerful tool, especially when it doesn't mean anything. So it's just a sound. So anyone that speaks any language can understand this hook. So whether you speak Spanish, Chinese, whatever, dum-dum-da-da-da-da is gonna be cool with you. So don't yawn on me, bro. I know you've been here all day, blood. Come on, you're nodding your head and yawning. So that's really important, all things you should bear in mind. So the next thing, the other side to it, you've written a song, the song's banging. You've got this really crap beat and you're like, cool, I'm gonna make the rest of this song. I definitely believe in production. I work really hard on it. But the way I work is in a lot more traditional sense. I look up to people like Kanye West as a producer, Timbaland as a producer, Quincy Jones, where the record making process is a lot more of a collective approach. The thought process behind that is I don't believe in doing everything yourself. So I believe in, if you're really sick at sound design, I'm gonna ask you to get involved with sound design in this. If you're really sick at, bass sounds, this is how we're gonna do it. So I like to work with people. Also, from a mental health perspective, it removes the isolation of being an electronic producer. So work with people, that's the way I see it. And on this particular record, I worked with Will Clark, not many people know, Mr. Big Booty himself, Fred Gibson, another songwriter, and Mark Ralph. I'm gonna share with you some of their contributions and then how we kind of got to the final point.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you, what would you say for a bedroom producer perspective with like that kind of thing? Because, you know, a bedroom producer is not going to really have a team like that. Would you say reach out to friends and stuff and just get as collaborative as possible?
Exactly. Bro, I'm 31 now. When I was doing my thing first starting out, we had MySpace. I had Alex the Kid hitting me on MySpace when he was like before he did like Love the Way You Lie and all that. Like, there's even more of a community. You know, I've seen Reddit. I see what you guys talk about, bro. Like, so it's kind of, there's so many more people. And these weren't things that I did in the room. I just send a record across. I say what I'm trying to get across and say, guys, send me back what you think. And then what I do is take the best elements that I believe in or edit it and then add to it. So it's not ghost production in that respect. If anyone wants to ask a question, I know there was a panel just now. Ghost production for me is if people aren't credited, they're paid and that's it. No one remembers. All these people are there on the credits and celebrated. Tomorrow's Ivor Novello is everyone else's award. So a few key things from the stems. Let's go. Here's your drum track, always worth listening to. Fairly standard drum track, feels good. Only thing I'll point out is this particular sound, which is this tom sound, super simple, just logic. All logic, bruv, Klopgeist in logic. The most stupid plugin in the world. I didn't even know where it does until this moment. This is what I'm trying to show to you. It's like mad simple. It's all about the idea. Obviously, I want to big up these guys. I use virtual tape on my instruments where it's like, it just makes things sound a bit wider. A little bit of drastic EQ in there. Again, everyone knows reductive EQ. I boosted that because it wasn't loud enough. Bit of compression. And then Valhalla, everyone knows about Valhalla. It's there, it's available, buy it, really good. So Will Clark did a bunch of, he gave me the greatest hi-hat in the world. Including the greatest hi-hat in the world, he added a really important synth, which is this. So this synth runs throughout the track. It's kind of like a Detroit technique, just to keep like some sort of string sound going throughout the tune. And that's the thing, all my production outside of the song is informed by classic house techniques. Just to give you a bit of insight, that's the startup sound on the Tao You Know X. It's just... And then you just got the cutoff opening, which is just over here. I made it, you know, ducked it all out and boosted it. Really simple stuff. So that was his thing that he added for me. Thank you very much, Will Clark. Then I went to see a guy called Fred Gibson. He's a really talented dude, and I really wanted to get... So this is actually quite jokes, actually, this element. Okay, I call this like my Eastern European house song sound. This like... So this was something that like I came up with Fred, and a lot of people don't know this is in the track. And before, when I first had started this tune, I used that as like a drop, you know, where it like happens after the vocal, and it was a bit too Kygo. Big love to Kygo, but man's doing my own thing. And again, just to share with you, Logic preset is called Curly Whirly in Sculpture. Super simple.
And it just mimics the top line.
Mimics the top line. It's all about repeating that hook. That's the way I see it. Made it sound a bit cruddy with little altar boy, usual kind of stuff. This is a good little trick that I learned from Second City back in the day. He basically popped some sample delay on these kind of sounds to make it feel a bit wider. It's all an illusion, really. You can set it to random stuff and it feels good. The last thing I kind of want to... Oh, this is always interesting as well. There's a classic record by Switch. Sugar, what's it called? If I need you the most, Andrea, I still love you by Switch, yeah? So he had these sick vocal pads, like, ooh, ooh. So I got Fred Gibson to add these kind of like vocal oohs that made a massive difference in the record. And then my fake Timbaland. That's not Timbaland, bruv. Yeah. And then obviously it's buried. So that's all that. These times now, I'm thinking, yeah, this record's big, bruv. This is where I got to, yeah. But I don't wanna sleep. It's quarter. So this is where I was at, like. And now it's like, it was like a month before release. I was like, yo, this is it. Then I played it to Martin Solveig and he canned my whole tune. He said, bro, you haven't got the emotion. This is poor. What are you doing? And it was because I was still holding on to that bass pattern from the first session. And this is my point. This is over like a 7-month period. Yeah? I've been working on this for 7 months. And my point is, I then played it to him and he gave me the crucial element to change the groove of the bass. And that's kind of what made the drop. And that's my point. It's not a spiritual process. You just feel it. Do you know what I'm saying? And you take it over time and you perfect. And we got to this song. Yeah, man. And then you do your thing, innit? Hold on, I just want to share this for the gas. Hold on.
If you know the words, let me
hear you. This is it, Serbia. Little thing there. Belgium. Tomorrowland. No one turned up, really. It was,
I hear you.
Cool. And cool, that's how you do it.
Thank you very much, Jax Jones. That was very helpful insight on the songwriting process. And that just proves that the idea is the most important thing.
Cheers, bro.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate your time.